Welcome everybody to the IMSC Algebraic Combinatorics Seminar. It's a great pleasure to have our own Digjoy Paul, who's going to talk about the quasi-P Steinberg character. Digjoy.
Thank you, Amri. Yeah, it's a long time I have not kept talk at IMSC, and I'm missing the green board and white chalk badly. So I started this thing, writing on the board. I don't know whether it will go well or not, because I'm less prepared here than the slides. Let's see. Okay. So this is joint work with Pooja Singla, who was at IIC Bangalore and now at IIT Kanpur. And she's my academic sister as well. Okay. So here is a plan for the talk. So I will start by giving some detail on some history and result on Steinberg representation, and then how Veit and Dörrafass has contributed this Steinberg representation in finite group setting, and then a recent question by Dipendra Prasad asked at a ICTS conference, and we'll answer his question as well as some new thing. So, there is some main theorem which I will going to do it a little bit later, but let us start with defining, defining or rather some saying some details about Steinberg representation. Okay. So let G equals to G of a Q. Q is some power of prime P is a finite group of Lie type. I hope the later is visible to you.
Yes, very.
Okay, thanks. So I put some quotes here, because to define finite group of Lie type is beyond of my capacity, at least in the talk. And let me just say a few words. If you start with any reductive connected algebraic group over a algebraic closed field FQ, let's say FQ closure, and if we take a Frobenius map or twisted Frobenius map, so from FQ bar to FQ bar, so we send element x to x power q, and if we extend this map on the group level, like if I define the same map from G of FQ to G of FQ bar, and we are starting with this something under, I mean, subgroup of some GLN FQ bar. And so we can think of that the matrix Aij goes to Aij power Q. And the fixed point under this Frobenius or twisted this Frobenius under this Frobenius map is exactly over FQ, G over FQ. As the fixed point under this math, under this x goes to x power q or fq. So this is how you something define group of Lie type. You start with any connected reductive algebraic group and take the Frobenius fixed point under the Frobenius map. And for rest of the talk, you can just simply assume that g equal to gln of her fq. So n by n matrix whose entry is coming from the field FQ. Okay, and let B is the corresponding Borel here. So for this GLN, it is just upper triangular matrix, and T is your maximal torus, maximal to rush, and it is a diagonal matrix. And so the while loop is just okay. Well, takes let's take n equal to the normalizer of that maximal to rush, and then this is just monomial matrices. Monomial matrices, then has defined the wild group equals to the n mod t, and in the case of GLN, it is nothing but symmetric group SN. Okay, and so this is the basic setup on which one can define what is something called Steinberg representation. So the construction I'm giving of Steinberg representation is by Curtis and independently by Veit, and they define it a ordinary representation of G, and it is defined by me define it first, and I will say what are those, or rather say here that given a wild group, you take the simple reflection here, simple positive roots. So these are just S 1, S 2 up to S n minus 1, and J is any subset of that, and then you take induction of the trivial from the parabolic subgroup to the group G. So what is parabolic subgroup? So let me define here itself. So when you have a Borel, parabolic subgroup is basically a subgroup of G which strictly contain Borel, and there is a one-to-one correspondence between this parabolic containing Borel with means they are indexed by J, where this WJ are the wild group or the subgroup generated by the reflection from the subset. Okay, let me just go through again. So you have Borel, then you define what is called parabolic, and there is a one-to-one correspondence between these subgroups generated by a subset of the positive simple roots, and you have this thing. So in particular for SN case, you could see that this WJ is this subset of these. This is nothing but Young subgroups, S lambda 1, S lambda 2, so S lambda L, where lambda is a partition of N, and yeah, and this is under this correspondence you get all the Borels P lambda. So
just a quick question. So this is defined for all finite groups of Lie type, is it?
Yes. So in general, it is true that
sigma, this root system, and so on is there is some. So there's a group defined over the algebraically closed. Is that the root taking?
Okay. So mainly this construction is for group finite group of Lie type.
Okay, maybe for non-split. Not sure.
Yeah, for the original definition of Steinberg representation, what he gave in that paper. That is not what I'm going to say here. I'm going to say a characterization of that which matches when finite group of Lie type. This is the theoretically this is the definition, and if you ask more motivation for that, then I can say that well Yeah. So what we can do, we can let us ask this question that if we take the summation of this with cardinality of this induction of trivial from the this, what is this representation? So like for the SN, every wild group has some representation called sine representation. Okay. And so, yeah, this how you can see here. And in fact, there is a correspondence between these, like, so the induction from the Borel to the group G of trivial is correspond to induction of the W from trivial, like all ones here. Means the, yeah, let me say this only, empty subset. So this is in the case of symmetric group, this is nothing but group algebra or regular representation. Yeah, regular representation. And yeah, and this is the Borel one. Let us take one example and see on this thing. So when G equal to GL2 FQ, then if you I'm just telling you the result only. If you take the induction, you should get one trivial plus one representation, and it is Steinberg. And in this case, the corresponding wild group is S2. And so the, yeah, any question? Okay, go on. So, and the group algebra for a regular representation of symmetric group on two letters is exactly the same, trivial plus sine. So you can see that the Stein representation corresponds to here.
And GL2, for, right? You have written GLN.
This is, oh, sorry. This is for GL2, huh? Even for when G equal to GLN, so we can guess the answer from group algebra. So the CS3 is a trivial times standard with two copies plus sine. So here all we can get induction from Borel to the group GL3. Is just you will get trivial plus some representation, it's called something 2 pi and plus Steinberg. Yeah, so just you can see that sine and Steinberg, how they are related. And yeah, this is what I know, at least. I don't know, I'm beyond of this.
What is this 2 pi you are
2 pi is some representation of GL3 FQ. And there are other one, which means pi occurs twice.
Oh.
So, yeah. So, yeah. It is a deal. 2 pi, let me rush 2 pi. So, here the point is that, yeah, given this setup, when you have a finite group of Lie type, then this is how they define what is Steinberg representation, inducing from the Borel and take the alternating sum. And there is some correspondence between the representation of GLN FQ and the corresponding wild group. And this is how they related. The Borel one correspond to the regular representation. And so the other thing also, if you take PJ here, you will get WJ here. And this is how it is related. But we are interested here the some property of this, the property of the corresponding character. So let us note down the, what about the character? What about the character? So if I name same the character Steinberg, and So at this is equals to this vanishes at p singular elements. So by p singular I mean that p divides order of g, and it is equals to the p part of centralizer at x. It's p part means the highest power of p dividing the cardinality of the centralizer corresponding to s, and when x is p regular, when p does not divide order of g. So
you want to say p divides order of x and p does not
divide order of thanks. P divides order of x and p does not divide order of x. So GCD of p with order of x equals to 1. And so for the dimension of this character is so is from this definition is the maximum power of p dividing order of 1, right? No, order of g, because cg of 1 is the whole g. So this is just cardinality of psi lo p sub root, right? So when x equal to 1, cg of trivial equals to the whole group, and so you should take really g mod p, which is by definition p power, the highest power which dividing order of g. Okay, and this character is known as p Steinberg character. And such a so these are the property. Okay, so Steinberg representation satisfies this property, or the this is the exact computation done by them. Okay, and for the finite group what Veit has extended this definition to the setting of finite group. So let us start with this thing. So let g from now on g is just a finite group, and p divides order of g. So so question is, as I said in the abstract, so the question is, suppose G has P Steinberg character. So what do you mean by that? So there exists some character chi of G. They are irreducible, actually, the Steinberg. So there exists some irreducible representation of G, which satisfies the following property, that the same property as defined here, right? So basically chi of 1 equals to p to the power e, where e is the maximum power, or sometimes it's called so e is the maximum power of p dividing order of g, and chi at g equals to I know I'm repeating the definition, but it's good to recall again. And p divides order of g, does not divide order of g, and g otherwise. So question is, characterize such groups. if G has Steinberg character, what you can say about what can you say about Lie type? Lie type. So this is a fact that if a group, if you have a finite group of Lie type, then such a Steinberg representation always exists. So here he asks the converse question. If you have a finite group, and suppose you have a Steinberg character, then what can you say about the Lie type? And this answer is not known in general.
So you're asking whether G is a finite group of Lie type, right?
Yes. Yes. So in particular, he asked for a semi-simple group. So he asked the following question then, which has some answer. So if G finite simple group, P divides order of G, and then does it follow that G is a semi-simple group of Lie type? So between these, and suppose G has P Steinberg character for some P, for that P Steinberg character, then does G a semi-simple group of Lie type?
I'm a little confused because there are finite groups of Lie type which are not semi-simple, like GL and FQ. So obviously those are counter examples to this. I mean, GL and FQ is not a semi-simple group of Lie type, and it has a P Steinberg character.
I understand the question.
But it is not simple.
Oh, it's not simple. Oh, okay. Yeah. Thank you, Raghav.
Yeah, correct. Thanks. Okay, so this is the question asked by Fight. And the answer is given by Darpshe. For GKL's two alternating group or PSLNQ. Okay. So the answer in general thing is, the answer is more general thing is not known here. Like so, for any finite,
one more question. So this question of prime, when you say it is for answer is given for PSLNQ, is it for all primes? I mean, otherwise it doesn't make sense, right? So you're saying that you take all primes P that divide the order of PSLNQ for some Q.
Yes, yes. Okay. So here we started with this thing, right? P divides order of G.
So for all primes, not the P, which is the characteristic of FQ.
Characteristics, I think.
No, that's fine. It must be all.
I think Q equals some P power thing.
But that's another P, right?
These are characteristics P.
No, but that P is not the same as this P in the conjecture. Otherwise, of course, it's trivially.
It is for all P.
Yeah, but then the conjecture also should say that is G a semi-simple group of Lie type over a field of characteristic P probably? Is that the conjecture?
Yeah, characteristics P, characteristics P. Yes, this is the thing, yeah, sorry, I should write fully.
And this P here is different, I think you should Q equals P to the K is not... I mean, you have to prove it for all primes. So, not only for the prime, which is Q, characteristic of.
Okay.
One second. Maybe my question will help answer Amri's question. When you say that given the answer, what do you mean? I didn't understand what the answer is. Could you give the complete statement first?
So the question is, maybe better you can directly go to the paper. Yeah, so forgive me, I'm just sharing the paper of the thing so that there is no confusion. So this is the this is the statement about the problem. G is one of the simple groups A and or PSL and Q, where Q is a power of prime. Power of a prime R. Let P be a prime dividing order of G. It is proved that G has a P Steinberg character. Then G is isomorphic to a semi-simple group.
Exactly. So I was saying you shouldn't write P there. He has written R.
Yeah, yeah. P could some prime R. And okay, so the answer of these two questions is not solved in general. And
do you want to erase that characteristic P at Q equals PK from that?
Characteristic, so this part, no?
Not this, lower.
Yeah, down. this thing, right?
No, down.
For any R equal to key?
Answer.
This is also?
And the answer that is R to the K, correct. And
character. Yeah, yeah. This part, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Where we are? Okay. So the original P Steinberg character, he's has these two property. One is about the highest prime power dimension, and the second is about the character value. Okay. So for SN and for SN and alternating group, one have the, so the alphas have the answer actually. So he answered for AN, so as well as for SN. So he has the answer that symmetric group satisfies the reverse conjecture. Okay, so not for a finite simple group. Suppose you asked for this question that you have a finite group and has P Steinberg character, then whether the group is finite group of Lie type, and you ask for G equal to SN, then the answer is as guessed that yes, they are. Okay, and you can see that here. Yes. So he has classified the irreducible representation of symmetric group which have some P Steinberg character here, and so the list consists of basically the symmetric group where n is strictly less than 7, and this is the list where you will see that this can be written as finite group of Lie type setting. So this clearly say that if SN satisfies having a P Steinberg character, then SN is finite group of Lie type. Okay. So what happened if we dilute some condition from the hypothesis here? Yeah. So what happens if we dilute some hypothesis here and ask the same question? Okay, so let us form two questions here. The first question, which one is asked by Diffie, I should say full name. Dipendra Prasad. At ICTS, So he asked that you start with a finite group and a prime P, which divides order of G, and G is said to have weak P Steinberg character. Weak P Steinberg character if the first condition is as there also, that the character, let's say it is chi, then the first condition say chi of 1 equals to the full dimension can be obtained there. So is the maximum power, so that P power E divides order of G. So this is the highest prime available on that group for this P. And the second condition, he dropped the exact cardinality. So chi of G to non-zero, if and only if G is regular. So order of G with P, this GCD is 1. Okay. And he asked the same question, that if G has this weak P Steinberg character, whether that imply G is finite group of Lie type. Finite group of Lie type. And so here you can see the changes in the definition. So from this definition, every P Steinberg character is weak P. Weak P Steinberg character.
Okay. I am still a little confused. Do you want G is finite group of Lie type of for that P or for A? What is?
Let me think about this thing. I don't think so. Let me go to the list. Yeah, as I said, that I have very less knowledge on a finite group of Lie type, so I always go to some reference to answer it. I think if these are the finite group of Lie types, then
can I say something?
Yeah, please.
Yeah, okay. I just wanted to say so. Fides, the conjecture, his conjecture was saying finite group of Lie type of characteristic P, but that was for simple groups. It's not true, for example, for S6, right? That it has a 3 Steinberg character, but it is not a finite group of Lie type of characteristic 3. It is only of characteristic 2. So for simple groups, it was. Does that answer, Raghavan?
Say lambda equal to 40 and P equal to.
So okay. So basically, are you saying that there are some finite exceptions to this?
Exactly.
Yes.
Morally, it is of type P, but there are some small exceptions to be
learned. Exactly. S6 gives that example. So it has a 3 Steinberg character, but it is not a finite group of Lie type of characteristic.
I think that's correct. But we do not know of infinite families of counterexamples.
Yeah, we don't know that. That's correct. Rather, most of these turn out to be, like, they don't have. For SN
and do we know of weak Steinberg characters which are not Steinberg characters?
Yes, that I think
we can speak about.
Okay, that same S6.
For alternating as well.
Okay. Yeah.
There are some example.
So that is part of your work, is it?
Yeah, and of course, you are defining something more here. So we want to define something more here, that we are dropping here the one conditions. So let me define the another one, which we call quasi phi Steinberg. Means we are in we inquired about that whether these conditions are necessary to conclude this result. So do you need to say that this finite group of Lie typing is totally different on or using all the conditions? And we have seen that if you drop down more condition, we can the hypothesis as well, you will get the almost same kind of result, but with more exception, with one or two more exception for SN and alternating groups and all double covers. And so now we define, so we are defining, we are reducing this part dimension thing, and it is vanishing on the p singular element, this condition. Okay, so we are making the hypothesis more weaker. So we are saying that starting as same, G finite, p is a prime dividing order of G, and we say that a character is quasi phi Steinberg if just this thing chi g is non-zero for every p regular element. Yes. And then we can ask the same question, that if g satisfy only this property, if g has some quasi phi Steinberg character, and if that imply whether g is finite group of Lie type or not, and hence the implication follows here. Suppose you have a weak p Steinberg, so the original p Steinberg is with full flavor, more conditions, which implies weak, and which implies quasi quasi Steinberg, and you will get you will have the counter example for the other implications. Okay, and what's surprising is that we are making the hypothesis much and much weaker. Still, we are for the symmetric group alternating and their double covers, we are almost get the same answer for p Steinberg or weak p Steinberg, and this is what we find here. So the irreducible representation of symmetric group and alternating group, they are indexed by partition of n, and lambda equals to n and 1 by 1 power n are corresponding respectively the trivial and the signed representation here. And so p, let phi be a stand p be a prime which divide the order of SN n factorial, then we classify the set of quasi phi Steinberg representation of SN, and this is the list for n equal to 3 4 5 6 7 8 and p equal to 2, 3, 5. Here is the following irreducible representation which are quasi p Steinberg. And at the beyond, there is nothing. So if SN has some quasi p Steinberg representation, then n must be less equal to 8. And the green indicates that the weak p Steinberg that Dipendra Prasad has asked, that these are the one which are weak p Steinberg, and SN beyond 7 is not a group of Lie type. Okay, so in the most general weaker hypothesis, we are getting only S8, right here, and we get a similar result for alternating group as well. And yeah, and for this case, if AN has some weak Peach-Sternberg character, then N must be less equal to 9. Okay. And this we should prove in this or sketch the proof here. But let me tell you how the other follows and then our technique. Okay. So for general, the first thing that Peach-Sternberg, okay, so some questions.
Can you go back to the list of this SN?
Yes. Yeah,
okay. Yes. Okay. Just to stare at it.
Okay. Right. Let me something. Let me say something about the. Yeah. So the for the first two Sternberg representation, Peach-Sternberg or weak Peach-Sternberg, you have the first condition that dimension should be prime power. Not only that, it should be the maximum prime that divides order of G. Okay. So for finite group, what are the prime power dimensional irreducible representation? There is a long history in the literature. And for the symmetric alternating and the double covers, Balog, Bessentrait, also Nanono, they have some answer here. So here they prove that if a irreducible representation of symmetric group, the dimension is some power of some prime, not necessarily the highest, then either that representation has to be standard representation. That means here n equal to p power plus 1 and lambda equal to n minus 1 comma 1. That is the standard one and dimension is p power r. Or you are in the exceptional case. So n equal to 4, 5, 6, 8, 9. Okay. And if you put the condition that this would be the highest prime power, then this part is just n equal to p plus 1 and lambda equal to p comma 1. And you will find a element here which is semi-simple, or sorry, I am changing the definition a bit, which is p regular, but the character value is 0. Let me repeat again. From this list, if you put that, if you consider the condition that the dimension should be the highest prime power, then you will observe that this r equal to 1. And in that case, you will get an element like from, like if you take this element 1, 2, 3 up to n minus 2, n minus 3, n minus 2 comma n minus 1, this element, then you'll see that since the standard representation, the character value is just number of fixed point of G minus 1. So here the only fixed point is n, so you will see that this is 0. And from that condition that P, and you will see that this element is also P regular. Okay, so P basically divides N, and so not dividing the this part. Okay, so that means what you left with only these special cases. Okay, so you can prove the Peach-Sternbergness or weak Peach-Sternbergness classification from this Balog, Bessentrait, also an ONO result. And for the proof that is lots more demanding than representation theory, it needs some number theory concepts and what we find very difficult to understand for us. So then we saw the work of Darabse, and our technique to prove our main theorems has means that technique has some influence from this proofs of these theorems. Okay. So let's sketch how you start classifying such quasi-P-Steinberg character. Okay. So for that thing, we will quickly recall the representation of a symmetry group or alternating group, or at least how to compute the character quickly. So I hope that everyone know the basic things. Still just recall that basically the Monaghan-Nakayama rule. Okay, if you have how much time I have, and Amri, how much time I have?
Yeah, you can take another 15-20 minutes.
15-20 minutes. Okay, great. Okay. So yeah, I'll just sketch the proof here. So let us directly go to the proof itself. Okay. So what is our target? So the irreducibles of SN are indexed by partition V lambda. Lambda partition of N, and its dimension of V lambda is given by Hooke length formula, which is n factorial by product of n factorial by product of all Hooke's, n factorial by product of Hooke's. So if you have partition 3-1, you should compute the hook at each steps and take the product. So like for a hook, you will take this length. This length is the hook, and you put the hook, the length of this thing here. So you do for every box, and then you compute this formula. Okay. And this is the dimension thing. And for the character computation, you will have to use Monaghan-Nakayama rule. Monaghan-Nakayama rule, and it says, I think directly by example, if I do that will be better maybe. So let's compute character of a partition. Do I need to compute it, or can I assume that everyone knows about the rule?
Could you please just recall the rule?
Okay. So let me just share a page so that I'll go fast. Just a minute. Yeah, let me share this thing. Yes. Can you see this?
I cannot see anything yet. Ah, yeah, here it is. Okay.
Harry, right? Okay, so it means I find this is, this will be a quick thing. So given a partition, you first write the hook numbers here. Then, given a permutation of cycle type alpha, alpha 1 to alpha r, you wanted to find chi lambda. Yeah. So, what is chi lambda of alpha? And then, what you have to do? You have to, this is sum of all the rim hooks that you remove from the diagram alpha. So you have a lambda, and you want to find what is that if alpha to alpha r. Then what you have to do from the partition, you have, suppose you first do for alpha 1, then you have to remove all the possible. So each hooks correspond to some rim hooks. So like for this thing, you will have this pipe length rim hook. So you have to remove this rim from the partition, and whatever the remaining shape, that is here, right? This chi lambda, chi of lambda mod nu. So nu is a rim hook of length some alpha I, and then that part is evaluated. So you write alpha minus alpha I. And let us compute one example here. I think we have done it. Yes. So suppose lambda equal to 3, 3, and you want to compute at 2, 4. Then what you do first, you see how many hooks are there with length 2. So you have here one hook and there one hook. So this is how you can remove. I put crosses here, and whatever the remaining shape. So the shape remains in this, the first case is 2, 2, and on the second case is 3, 1, and you have computed at 2. So you have to compute on the 4 element again. So on the remaining shape, you have to do again the same. Okay. And in the remaining shape, you again compute the hook lengths and you find it finally. And the sign of this thing is the number of the height of the rim, right? -1 to the power height -1. So for example, if you have this hook, I think you can understand this part. And these two are what is needed. These two color is most needed for this for our proof. So let me annotate this part. So this Monaghan-Nakayama rule says that when the character value is zero, so it says that if lambda does not have a hook of length alpha I for some I, so you have a partition lambda, you have to compute at some character, some element of cycle type alpha. So if you find that in that given partition lambda, if there is no hook of size alpha I for some I, then it says that the corresponding character value is zero. Okay. And the other one is the recursive one, that you can do, you can apply this recursively, that given alpha equal to two parts, alpha one, alpha two, if the character value is zero, it is zero if, means you have some lambda, then you can, if that possible that you can remove the alpha one, then whatever the remaining shape, lambda minus alpha one, if there is no hook length of no hook of length alpha two, then also the character value is zero. So these two arguments we will use repeatedly for the proof.
So sorry, here alpha is a partition with just two parts, is that right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, and when you say lambda minus alpha 2, what does that mean? That hook, is it?
Lambda means you remove the corresponding rim hook from the partition lambda.
But alpha 1 is just a number. There is only one hook, or do you remove that hook? Okay.
Okay. Then I think I should say here the rim of size alpha 1, right?
Some hook of,
This is a mistake. You should write rim of size alpha 1. So let me directly go to the proof now. I also need the alternating group representation a little bit. So once you know the representation of symmetric group, you can restrict that representation, and depending on
two case, you can get the restriction. So if lambda is non-self is not the conjugate, lambda and lambda prime if they are different. So I think you know what is lambda prime. So it is a conjugate. So you basically changes all the rows to columns. So this will be 2, 1, 1. Okay. So for this case, the restriction remains irreducible. So restriction of Sn of, so you start with V lambda A irreducibles of Sn, and this is irreducibles. And let us, if chi lambda is the corresponding character of Sn, if chi lambda is the character of Sn, then let us write this restriction character as chi lambda restricted to this. So this is the case when a lambda not equal to lambda prime. And if lambda equal to lambda prime, then you will get two different representation, means the restriction of Sn comma An to An of V lambda. Now it is equals to direct sum of two different irreducibles, which is we can call it some plus and minus, and the corresponding character chi lambda and chi lambda minus. So for reference, you can see Amri's book on symmetric group and alternating. You will get a good basic thing about it. And here he proved the following result here, that if chi lambda of W, means the computation of character value, is twice the chi lambda of twice the chi lambda of the thing, if so type of the permutation is a partition, if it is not belongs to, means if it is not a distinct, if all the parts are not distinct of odd length, okay, distinct part of odd length, and it is something which need a time to display otherwise. So this result you can find in Amri's book. And the main lemma data that we are using, so we know how to compute combinatorially the character of symmetric group using Murnaghan-Nakayama rule. And the since a normal subgroup Sn, and we have this following property, they are decomposed and they have some character relation among them, then what we can show that for these two kind of representation, so the first one is the restriction and the second is that plus minus. So if star belongs to N, then chi lambda star of W non-zero if and only if chi lambda of W is non-zero. So yeah, this is the result you can easily conclude from basic result of alternating and symmetric character. Okay. If any confusion on this result itself, the statement. So this star be one of these two things. For the conjugate and non-conjugate thing, you will get three type of representation. This restriction and this plus minus, and all of them will satisfy this kind of property. Okay. So now we don't have much time. So let me directly go to some proof. Okay. So what we are doing? So suppose we are looking for irreducible representation such that our dimension, the lambda is quasi P. quasi-Pechenberg for some prime dividing n factorial, and as well for the alternating the list. You can see that there is this relation among it, because suppose you have chi lambda star. This is P. Steinberg for An. That means chi lambda star of G is non-zero for all element G belongs to An, which are P regular. That means order of G BCD with P equals to 1. Right? So this P regular element of An and Sn, they have the containment relation, right? So if something is Sn P, if something is P Steinberg for Sn, that must be P Steinberg for An. So if chi lambda star P Steinberg for Sn, that imply corresponding chi lambda is P Steinberg. Oh, I should say quasi Steinberg for An. Okay. So let us first then describe these sets, and we'll deduce the Sn case from there. Okay. Is it okay up to here?
Yeah.
Okay. So let us case that how you want to do it. So let's start with P is a odd prime. Do this case. P is a odd prime, and P divides the cardinality of An, that is n factorial by 2. And lambda is a partition of An, which is not trivial or sign, because they are the basic representation. You can handle with here them. Then let us do the first case. Means in this case, we'll first characterize what are the possible lambdas remains after you put those conditions of the hypothesis. So we start first this case. P does not divide N, and N is odd. Okay. Then since N is odd, so you can take an element with cycle type N, and since N is odd, the corresponding, since N is odd, you take mu equal to N, and you take the element cycle type mu, and since N is odd, this is belongs to An. Okay, and order of sigma mu is N. And this is the case that P does not divide N. Okay, so by the hypothesis, chi lambda star at sigma N must be non-zero. This is what we are doing, right? We are looking for all the representation chi lambda, psi that chi lambda of G non-zero for all G where P does not divide order of G. So P does not divide N, and you take an element with order N, and which is also in alternating group, you will have this thing. And a lemma stated earlier that if this is non-zero, then we can say chi lambda at this point is also non-zero. And applying Mundaghan-Nakayama rule, Mundaghan-Nakayama, you have to say that there exists a hook of length n lambda. Are we agree with this? Because otherwise the character value will be zero. If there is no hook of length n in lambda.
That is your Mn1, right?
Yes, Mn1. So if I do only compute this thing, this is zero if lambda has no hook of length n. So since this is non-zero, you must have hook of length n. So that characterizes the partition, right? So lambda is such a, lambda must be such a partition where you will get a hook of length n. Then there is no choice other than this. So the lambda must be a hook, correct? So lambda partition of n, and if you have something here, you will miss something here. So lambda must be a partition of n. So this is the first. So first time we are applying the definition and we are getting it. Okay. And what you will do, we'll reduce the thing frequently. Okay. More. We'll reduce it more. Okay. Let's do the next case that. So depending on lambda is conjugate or non-conjugate, you can always find it. So suppose m is the leg length of this thing. So this part is your n minus m minus 1. So you can say that n if it's less than equal to n minus m plus 1, n minus m minus 1, right? So n is greater than 2m plus 1, or the conjugate one, that's why I'm saying. So if lambda is that, you can take the conjugate also. Okay. So this is the assumption here. So now let us look at the hook length. So here you will get the trick that the character value is zero if there is no hook of length something at that kind of element. So you will start thinking about the missing hook length in the diagram. So what is the hook length here? Let me change the other color. So you'll get n. N minus m minus 1. Let me do it in a broad picture. This is n, this is n minus m minus 1, and this is n minus m minus 2 and dot dot 1, and here it is m 1. Okay, this is now the hook length. So let's consider two partition where alpha 1 is n minus 2 comma 1 comma 1. So finding this, okay, let me conclude it, then I'll say, so, and n minus 3 comma 2 comma 1, and suppose m is greater than 3. So if you have these two partition cycle type, then see that so we are starting with the case that p is not dividing n. Then n minus 2 and n minus 3 are two conjugative number. Then one of them, either if it does not divide order of alpha 1, I don't think you should write it. Okay, let's take the corresponding element. Take the corresponding element with cycle type n, cycle type alpha 1 and alpha 2. So either if it does not divide this, or if it does not divide order of sigma alpha 2. And since n is odd, so n minus 2 is also odd. So this element belongs to An, and we know that if you have an even number like here, and if you multiply by a element of cycle type 2 by even by 2, then this will again be, sorry, this is what I'm doing. Even and if you multiply by 2, this is again an element of An. So you have two element which is in An, and the order, since is n minus 2 and n minus 3, they're conjugative. So one of them must true. Either P does not divide order of sigma alpha 1 or P does not divide order of sigma alpha 2, right? And so by the hypothesis, you must have chi lambda of sigma alpha 1, either this is non-zero. Sorry, I'm missing something. Sorry. So by the hypothesis, I must have this, right? For one of the element, I must have this thing. But see, this n minus 2 and n minus 3. So now you apply the Murnaghan-Nakayama for the symmetry case for this element. N minus 2 comma 1 comma 1. And see that in both case, this value is 0. As n minus 2 and n minus 3 is not a Hooke number here, because m is greater than or equal to 3. So this number is at least n minus 4 and less, right? And we have assumed this length is smaller than the other. So there is no chance of getting that. So n minus 2 and n minus 3, both are missing from the hooks. Both are missing hooks. So by Murnaghan-Nakayama, they are 0. And by the lemma stated earlier, or the relation between alternating and sign thing, you will also get that the corresponding alternating character is as well 0, and which contradicts to the assumption. Are you agree with this?
This means n is greater than or equal to, like, n is big enough, right?
Yeah, so m is greater than or equal to 3, and n is greater than or equal to, as I said that earlier, n is greater than 2m plus 1, so n is bigger. N is greater than or equal to 6, 7. Right? Yeah. N is greater than or equal to 7. So if m greater than or equal to 3, we have two contradiction. We have a contradiction. So that imply that m must less equal to 2. So conclusion is, m is less than equal to 2. So we'll handle this case separately. Suppose m equal to 2, that means you have this partition 2, 1, n, and this is n minus 3, n minus 4 onwards. Okay, and then again, you can see that n minus 2 is missing. N minus 3. Yeah. So n minus 2 is also missing. Okay. And so you can construct an element here which is in An, and whose order is not divisible by P. So P does not divide order of this element as in the previous case. Right. So what is the chance? So by Murnaghan-Nakayama, you can again apply that sigma. If you say this is alpha, then chi lambda of sigma alpha is non-zero, right? So this implies there must be a Hooke of length n minus 2. So n minus 2 cannot be from this list. because this starting with n minus 3 endless and n is odd. So n minus 2 cannot be equal to 2. So it must have that n equal to, n minus 2 equal to 1. So n equal to 3. So that means what? We are getting a one dimensional dependence, right? When n equal to 3 and lambda equals 2, just did this thing. And for directly from n equal to 3, A3 is the abelian group. So all the irreducibles or the dependence are one dimensional. So they are clearly quasi three Steinberg. So we remain to prove the other case when m equal to, I think here we have, this is true if, when m equal to 2, this is true if p does not divide in minus 2. So, you know, this is the recursive algorithm that we are applying again and again. So in this case, we are saying, assuming that p does not divide in minus 2, then we'll assume when this thing, so m equal to 2 and p equal to n minus 2, then you again pick some hooks which are missing and apply Moynihan kind of rule to contradiction, to find contradiction or something. So in this way, we'll characterize the partition, what quasi Steinberg, and we have managed to do it for every case. Okay, and I don't want to go through the every cases now. And once you do have some, figure out that these are the one which are quasi P Steinberg for alternating, then it is easy to find from the definition. Means from this list, you have to check which are quasi P Steinberg for SN. And since a dependence problem has some two more data, that it must be a prime power dimensional, and this should be zero on the P singular element as well. So, but the point is that here you have only finite number of representations with lambda has some particular shape, and from the Balogh theorem as well, Balogh Bessendorf result, you know what are the dimensions of it. So you can check whether that representation is of highest prime power or not. And from the character table in smaller case, you will conclude that what are quasi P, what is weak P, or what is original P Steinberg characters. Yeah, that's all.
Thank you.
I think for the double cover things, I don't have time today. Maybe if you want, we can do it next week or sometime later.
Okay, we'll discuss that.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dig.
Yeah. Any question?
Vishwanath, we can't hear you. You have a question or?
No, I didn't. I didn't ask him.
Yeah, maybe I can make a question. This is a question that we are not able to answer. If somebody can point us in the direction, it will be helpful. So, is it okay if we ask that question? So there's something that.
Of course, go ahead.
Something is interesting here. So in this list that we have got, so quasi P did not have any dimension condition in the hypothesis, right? It was only that the chi G is not equal to zero for every P regular G. That's all the hypothesis was. But the list, the one that we have got, all the quasi P for SN, AN, and the double cover, all of these are prime power P dimensions for that P. So we don't know why that happened. That's something. Why chi g not equal to zero on p regular? Is it always the case, or something? But converse is not true. Not every prime power is a quasi p. So it's one way. Quasi p implies it's a prime power. We're not able to prove that part yet.
I mean, no, you've proved it, right? No.
We have proved it in the sense, now we know. Yeah, we know because we know the full list.
By exhausting, yeah.
Exactly. By doing this, we know, but we are asking, is there a natural reason
for it? There's a reason for it.
Exactly.
And that's very intriguing, yeah.
Yeah, we don't know why that happened.
And yeah, means I have the other question also, that suppose you have the highest prime power dimensional representation, does it follow that it vanishes on the p singular elements?
That does, I think, right? That's something called defect.
Defect zero?
Defect zero, I think that is. Defect, I mean, zero. I know this is, proof is by Isaacs. I'll show you the reference.
Okay. Yeah.
I have a question, not a question actually. Can you clarify the relation between your result and the result of Besenrot and et al?
Yes. So I think maybe Rigjal can answer.
Clarify, I mean, so.
So the two results, they seem to be somewhat related. Does one imply the other, or are they some? I couldn't quite see
the
relation between.
Let us check from the list itself. So this is the Besenrot Balog also result. So here they are taking care of it about only prime power dimensional representations. Need not be highest one.
Okay.
And here is the.
These are the exceptions. They're not talking about vanishing on.
No, nothing. They're only taking care about the prime power dimensional. And that's why you are getting here the standard representations.
Right.
Okay. But if you put those vanishing condition, then you will not get this thing, standard one.
Surprisingly, with our vanishing condition, with non-vanishing condition, let's say, and no dimension condition, we get our list is a sub-list of theirs.
Yes. Yeah.
So that is something very surprising for us. Huh. Why that's happening?
So, but your techniques cannot get their result where they classify all the three powers.
Yeah, no. Because there are prime powers which are not quasi-P.
Right. So that really needed, you feel, some them. So it may be that they really needed those analytic techniques there.
Yeah. But from their result, it is very easy to follow the other ones. Because if you put only the prime power and highest prime power, you have only finite number of things. And you can check in SAGE or GAF about P standard bar, cos P standard bar, or even the weak one. Right.
Sorry, from their result, what can you deduce easily?
So these are the all representations which have the prime power.
Yeah, but nothing about character values.
Nothing about character value. Yeah. But in other definition, like the original Peach-Chanberg or
what did we say? Both the conditions.
Yes, that have the first condition. There should be not only the prime power, it is the highest prime power, right?
Yeah.
Also the second characterization.
So because you have weakened the hypothesis, their result no longer gives. Okay, I get
it. Yes. Yes, this result does not give our quasi thing.
Yeah.
Because we are not assuming prime power thing, prime power dimensional thing in our hypothesis. But this result gives the other two.
Yeah.
Weak one and the Peach-Chanberg one.
Okay, I think
so. We cannot prove this result, means from our technique or from this technique.
And they cannot prove your result. Yeah, your
result is. And there is some containment, which also is not.
And also there is some containment. The list are very finitely many.
So it's quite intriguing. Yeah.
But see, the proof techniques what we are using, it is just means bookkeeping kind of thing. You find some good element. You have to find something good element which violate something and applying the Murnaghan Nakayama kind of rule. Yeah. And also for the, go on.
Maybe people in modular representation theory will have better intuition about why such things happen. I don't know.
I'm sorry, I have a question.
Yeah, please.
In your list of exceptional cases for this Balog-Besenrot result, they're all pairs that are conjugate. Is that because of the going through an? Is that what's happening there?
I think they, no.
No, it is because of the dimension of the conjugate one is the same as the dimension of the lambda, right? And they were only writing.
I see. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Any more questions? Well, it looks like there are no more questions. So let's thank Digjoy once again.
Thank you for allowing me to talk here. It's right here.
Very interesting talk. Thank you.
You're welcome.